Thank you. Thanks for inviting us to be here. Happy to see so many people still around. My name is Lasse Ståhl, CEO of Additab. We have integrated additive manufacturing with injection molding to circumvent some of the barriers that we've been hearing about today a couple of times. You can see it live out there in the hall after the show, if you want to. And without further ado, if I can get this to work, the findings that motivate everything we do in Additab right now are the constraints that product developers, product managers face when looking at components. I think anybody in this room has heard the statement, yeah, this is a brilliant material you've got, but we sorely cannot 3D print it at the present stage. Alternatively, from the management, you may hear something like, ah, sorry, we cannot really see that the investment is justified by the business case, so with such a big investment, we have to cancel the project. Another typical is, whoops, I messed up the mold design. So now we are facing a 6 or 8 week rework. And finally, one from Airbus. That's an out-of-stock component because we need to produce it specifically with certified materials. It's a 9-month lead time. That's painful. This arises because in spite of 4 industrial revolutions, we still have a prototyping system and a production system that does not communicate. Injection molding is the mainstay of global manufacturing, brilliant technology for making a lot of parts, cost-efficiently, perfect solution. Additive manufacturing is perfect for low-volume production, short lead times, low startup costs, full design freedom. But there is a gap in the middle of the road. And that gap is causing a lot of problems, because if you're using 3D printing for the prototyping, and you know you're going to end up with injection molding in the end, you will at some point have to transition from the 3D printing to the injection molding with all the costs, all the time, all the risks associated with the transition. That lack of compatibility is one of the key challenges that additive and injection molding are facing together if we really want to do a difference to product development, product lifecycle management. But if we could combine the value propositions of these two brilliant technologies, we would be facing an entirely different situation, because then we'd be able to use the low startup costs, short lead times, and design freedom from additive to enhance injection molding. That means getting to real injection molded parts quicker, cheaper, lower risk. Everybody wins. And then, of course, we get the most versatile additive manufacturing platform on the planet, because we remove the material constraints from additive, while at the same time removing some of the investment problems that injection molding is facing. So that's pretty much what I do. And as you can see out there, it is really a question of 3D printing a part, putting it into an injection molding machine, injecting whatever material is in the machine, and then dissolving the tools. So the process, visualized, looks a lot like this. 3D printed molds with injected parts, and then after the removal. So that's what I had as my part. And then the more interesting part is, what can we do with that technology? And there, Peter Bay is definitely more skilled than I am.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, so so my name is Peter. And just to give you a very short background to what I am, I'm actually an old colleague of Tu. I'm also an old colleague of Tommy, if you recall the guy who was very early on the stage, Tommy Ahlers. And I can tell you today, he was kind of at a slower pace than normal. So for any of you who recall sort of the energy he brought up, he was actually at a low pace. Anyway, from background, I'm a plastics processing engineer. So I know a lot about plastics processing. 3 years ago, I stepped into my family company, took over this 60-odd-year-old injection molding company, and tried to look at, what are we going to do? I mean, are we going to continue another 60 years doing what we've been doing so far? Or are we going to do something different? Obviously, AM was one of those areas that we really wanted to dive into and explore if there were any opportunities for us to do something there. There you go. What I realized when I looked into this is that for AM, for me, it would typically be an option of direct 3D printing. You know, I would print a part, but there are tons of guys who can do that. You've got Dambi out here, you've got many other guys who are very skilled at doing that. So that was not really a space for me. Secondly, you know, I had the option of going to my conventional injection molding tool, and I would be facing the typical challenges that I always have with my clients. My clients, you know, they have a design. They're not completely certain about what it's going to be. They have concerns about dimensions, mechanical stability, and so on. So I needed to find a way to make AM support my normal injection molding business. And then 2 years ago, I happened to be at a sort of meeting like this, similar to this, and I met Lasse. And suddenly I could see some dots matching up here, because suddenly I had a platform which would combine the strengths of my injection molding machine with the strengths of additive manufacturing. I had the flexibility that we have been talking about from AM, plus I had the full library of plastic injection molding materials that I could use in these tools. So it was this puzzle that I've, you know, been working on trying to solve, this thing about getting into a solution where we are working with short lead time, geometrical flexibility, processing similarities, and material properties. That's typically what I see my clients, you know, wanting to have their answers on it, but I could, you know, it was always a compromise. It was a compromise between, you know, getting close enough and how much investment are we willing to put up front. And then, of course, time to get there. So what I want to leave you with is to take you through two examples of how we have used this for a number of clients, and how this has both saved time and money and energy, because in one case, this actually meant that the product failed. It showed that this was not the right design. But you know, that's also a success, because then you know, you have saved the planet for a lot of wasted resources, which would have been, you know, the alternative. So let's go to that one first. That's an example for a high-end bathroom appliance product. And if you are a high-end bathroom sort of appliance product manufacturer, then one of the things you're really concerned about is the touch and feel. What you can see here is a little sort of snap connection. And that little snap connection, we could, of course, 3D print it directly. But once this one goes into mass manufacturing, it would be an injection molded part. And it needed to be made in POM, a typical plastics product or material. And you know, we didn't have that option with 3D printing. So the option was to go with freeform injection molding. And you know, while we could both test the right material from the right process, we could also actually make a few different designs. So for this client, we made a few different designs, a few different sort of changed a few dimensions and so on. They put them in, put it into their high-end product to see if you know, this gave the right feel and touch when you turned the knob and whatever. It didn't. So you know, I could send them one invoice, and that was kind of the end of that business. But anyway, you know, it's successful because we didn't end up wasting a lot of time and resources on something that would otherwise have been the case. The second one, oof, that's big. Something that you wish you never ever see. It's a life jacket, light holder. So it's if you ever are on a cruise ship and the ship goes down, you know, you grab a life jacket, there's going to be this light. There, typically, these never see daylight. But if they ever do, you don't want to be the sort of manufacturer who has produced something that failed. You know, we didn't find the client because the light had fallen off. You know, it's down on the bottom of the ocean and the client died. What these guys are very concerned about is, of course, that they want to manufacture a sort of holder which will stay within the life jacket. So those small things, the little steps standing out there, they actually stick within the foam within the life jacket. And you know, they want to redesign this this holder, and we are doing that right now as we are talking, actually, and we are testing it, because if we are going to do this, of course, we need to make sure that it doesn't go out of this phone. And, you know, it was pretty amazing to see what Autodesk could do with a, you know, simulation. Maybe we could do the same, but on the other hand, in this process, it's something we do within a week. We can produce this prototype out from the right process, the right materials, put it into a life jacket, you know, pull it with a certain amount of weight and see if it sticks in there. So, you know, as it is right now, we are pretty close to a new design. The new design is going to be easier to manufacture. It's going to be less tooling cost. It's going to be easier to assemble and so on. And most importantly, it's going to stick in the life jacket. So on that note, I will pass on to a final page, or landing page, as we call it. And then we can get on to some questions, if you have any.
OK, so if I'm still on, OK, sure. So we are going to be challenging ourselves a bit. We actually claim that we can move from a component in a CAD file to a component in the flesh in 24 hours. We're going to be building a two-day seminar that'll showcase this process. The first day we will be spending on design work. We will be developing the CAD model. We will be 3D printing. We will be having a look at the injection molding part of it, get some material into the molds. Then we'll send some of the parts we mold for quality assurance by means of CT scans. We actually want to see the product before we remove the molds. And then overnight, we're going to be removing the molds. That's a dissolving process, so it takes a little time. But by the start of day two, we can actually click together the product that we have made on day one. And that product will be made in the launch-grade materials in a process that is industrially scalable, because at the end of the day, it's injection molding. And then I hope we'll have a good talk with the managers who are going to be visiting on day two to see what kind of impact it would do to their organizations to be able to move from concept to conceptualization in 24 hours. So you have the opportunity to sign up at the EAM Hub website. I think there may still be a little bit of confusion, but the right dates are the 17 and 18 of March 2020. And we are going to be selecting the location based on the number of participants, so hope to see a lot of you there. That's it.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Thank you, Peter.